There it
Good
is.
afternoon, Dr. Carstensen. Thank you so much for coming on and taking the time out of your busy, busy schedule to chat with me. Welcome.
Thank you, Brittany. I'm enjoying the concept of talking to a myofunctional therapist about all the things we can do together. It's fantastic.
Absolutely. I'm so excited for this conversation. Let's get started by telling the audience a little bit about your background and kind of your journey from restorative dentistry into what you do pretty much on a daily basis now.
Sure. I've been a dentist for 37 years, and for 32 of those, I was a restorative dentist. One of my early mentors is Dr. Keith Thornton. He started training me down at Pankey Institute about restorative things. Then, lo and behold, he became one of the pioneers of treating adults with oral appliances to help them breathe better at nighttime. So as he grew in what his interest level grew, he would reach out to those of us around him and say, wow, you should do more of this. Mm-hmm. And about 22 years ago, I started doing more of this. I began my sleep apnea treatment with adults and carried on like that for, 15, 16, 17 years. And then, you know, it kind of became obvious that children had a lot to do with these adults that are growing up to have breathing problems when they sleep. Early on, 20 some odd years ago, they didn't pay any attention to children. They had no data. They had nothing to treat them with and all that. And so as that has become certainly more important, then my focus is turning from my clinical work. I shouldn't say it that way. I still do clinical work on adults, but my long-term focus, my mm-hmm. passion is to bring dentists and other healthcare providers to little kids and see, well, what can we do? And that's where myofunctional therapy comes in, because it's fantastic. In fact, it's vitally necessary mm-hmm. for that to be part of any healthcare providing team to treat little kids. And if we're gonna help grow new generations of better breathers, then we have to have dentists that are trained in this and physicians and myofunctional therapists. So about 5 years, well, now about 5.5 years ago, my partner and I opened our clinic of treating just sleep apnea in Bellevue. We sold our general practices, and that's all I've done. And it's all my teaching's been doing since 2011. So I'm kind of all in on this.
Absolutely. And I feel like once you make that dive in, you have no choice. There's like no turning back. You can't help yourself, but, you know, dive deeper and deeper. Let's talk about the exciting projects that you're working on with the ADA. I know a new brochure came out that you co-authored and, you know, really shifting that focus to proper development of the craniofacial respiratory complex, starting in children.
Sure. This is part of what got very exciting for me. In 2017, the ADA was about to pass a policy statement, their first policy statement ever that bridged the gap between dentistry and medicine. And in the second paragraph is about kids. So as I was looking over that upcoming policy statement, I was in Chicago. Actually, the co-writer of my the brochure and I were there with the education department. We were recording some videos for the ADA. And we came up with this idea. Well, if we're going to have a policy statement and it's going to talk about kids, something that's kind of new and different for dentists to think about kids' airway, then maybe we should have some policies, develop some protocols, some education. Mm-hmm. And the education director of the ADA said, well, that's a good idea. And that was in August or September. Mm-hmm. The policy statement passed in October. And it took me 7 months to convince ADA to say yes. But after they did, I assembled it. And in 2018, in August, we had a summit meeting. And the summit meeting was an amazing collection of leaders from airway issues, from kids' issues, from myofunctional therapy, from orthodontics and pediatrics, and everybody across the board, all of whom said yes immediately when I asked them to come to Chicago on their own dime to meet with us about kids' airway. And the ADA executive director called me persistent, so I kind of like that too. And that began the process of creating a task force. So now we're going to come up with a new children's airway screener. We've got other parts of that volunteer organization and others that have joined us now to continue on talking about what we can do for kids' airway.
Yeah. And it excites me so much every time I hear something. I'm a dental hygienist. That's my background. And to know that, you know, this is going to be talked about more, because even when, you know, there's times that I get referrals from an orthodontist and, you know, the parents come in and they think I'm just going to talk about the way that their child swallows. And then when I start to tell them that that tongue thrust is really, you know, a compensation to the airway, they're looking at me like I have five heads. Like, well, what? Like nobody ever told me this. Or I start asking more about sleeping patterns and, you know, how they're breathing. And it's just so exciting to know that there's going to be even more awareness, even more of a focus on this, to the point where hopefully by the time they get to me, they already kind of have an idea, you know, about what the underlying issues are, what the underlying causes are. So I'm super excited for all of this.
You know, when you think about healthcare and people's interactions with healthcare, the one person everybody spends the most time per year with is their dental hygienist. Mm-hmm. So I'm a big fan. My wife's a dental hygienist. We've been married for almost 37 years. So I'm a big fan of hygienists. But the extra cool part is that hygienists, with their training, can go on and become myofunctional therapists, mm-hmm. with, you know, less of a burden than somebody who starts from scratch. Mm-hmm. And that gives the dental hygienist so much more impact on what they can do to help families. And nobody becomes a dental hygienist who isn't interested in making people healthier. And so too much work, it's too much money, it's too much everything if you're not mm-hmm. really passionate about helping people raise their level of health. Mm-hmm. This gives them another opportunity. And that's kind of like treating airway issues or breathing issues or structural issues is for us in dentistry as well, dentistry as a whole. Because the super interesting part is people come into the dental office, they talk to their dental hygienist, they talk to their dentist, the trained team member, and somebody brings up the concept of breathing. And, well, why are you asking me from a dental perspective? Gives us a whole nother reason to be important for those patients. Absolutely. And you mentioned a term there I love that Dr. Kevin Boyd developed called craniofacial respiratory complex. Mm-hmm. That's too, I tell Kevin all the time, Kevin, I love your concept. It's too long of a word. It's too fancy, too complicated. We got to come up with something else, but it's accurate, isn't it? For us trained in that we don't tell patients about craniofacial respiratory complex. Mm-hmm. We talk about breathing. We talk about the nose. We talk about the back of the throat. We talk about the size of the jaw. And these are the areas that only dentists are trained in. Now, our ENT colleagues, of course, have a lot to do with that, but only dentists are trained in the growth of that whole craniofacial respiratory complex. Mm-hmm. So it's up to us. It's up to you, the hygienist and the myofunctional therapist, even the lactation consultants, itty bitty babies, to consider what can we do to make sure that complex is optimized during the years we have a chance to make an influence. And that's where dentistry comes in, because when I think about my practice of adults, I need other providers. I need CPAPs, I need oral appliances, I need surgeons, I need all orthodontists, I need all those people to help these 50 and 60 year olds get healthier. Mm-hmm. But when I'm a dentist who's well-trained, when I'm a dental team member, when I'm part of a group, then I got a 4-year-old in my practice, I don't really need anybody else. I might need an ENT doctor, right, but I'm in charge. And that gives a new way for dental teams to feel important. And not that that's the most important thing, but to be able to use their skills and passion mm-hmm. to make a giant difference in patients' lives in ways that they never could before. You know, absolutely. If a dental hygienist is kind of getting tired of telling people to floss, And because, you know, and then they can say, well, you know what? I've got something that'll make your baby feel, or your little child at school, let's say, you know, behave better in school. And what do they wake up cranky? I can help you with that. Yep. And moms are going to pay attention because this is new conversation. And so all of a sudden we have a new professional challenge. It's interesting. It's, mm-hmm. it's something more to learn. It's not the same old, you know, it's just, to me, it's a great opportunity.
It's exciting. So I know you were recently on with Lauren Gates with Airway Health Solutions, and Kreese and myself, my partner in crime, we are teaming up with them, and Airway Health Solutions is now offering a myofunctional therapy course to hygienists. And I am so excited for our first course runs. It's March 19th and March 26th, but I keep saying how jealous I am because I wish when I started in myofunctional therapy that I was already set up in an office that was doing airway. So a lot of these hygienists that are taking the courses because the doctors already took the expansive techniques of Dr. Moralia. So I'm like, what the value that you're going to add to the practice to be able to offer this in four walls, literally, you guys are all there. It is just so, so exciting. And like I said, I'm kind of low-key jealous of them because I didn't have that. And I wish I did. But I'm so happy, you know, to be able to be a part of it. And it's just, you're changing lives. And, you know, I wanted to be a hygienist literally since I was seven, which is really weird. But I never knew, I never changed my course. I always wanted to be a hygienist. And I loved every single part of it for 10 years that I practiced, but I never knew that I could love my career even more, right? As a myofunctional therapist, but still being able to use that, like you said, the same skill set as a hygienist. Even though I'm not in the dental setting now, I still feel like, you know how it is. Like the doctor goes in, the doctor leaves, and the patient turns to the hygienist and is like, okay, explain this to me more, or what should I do? And I still feel that same, I don't want to say the middleman, but I just feel like I still can be, I'm an even bigger advocate for my patients now as a myofunctional therapist. And it's just so rewarding.
Advocate on a bigger field. And Brittany, I tell you, just judging from your response here, dentistry misses you as a dental hygienist. We need dental hygienists with that kind of passion and focused on getting people, not just their teeth clean, not just, you know, getting their preventive appointment done, important stuff. But what we really need them is the ones that are just, you know, can't contain their commitment to getting people healthy. Mm-hmm. And now to be able to expand that into, what do you do with that tongue now that the arch is bigger?
Right.
You know, when Dr. Morali is finished with his orthodontic treatment, or Dr. Bacow in my town, or any of the great orthodontists that work with these kids, then now what? I mean, because those habits are formed from the first days of life, as babies learn to suck, to breastfeed, as they learn to use the bottle. Whatever it is, those muscle patterns, I'm not telling the myofunctional therapist anything, but our profession needs to understand that's how early these habits start. And so when you go in with a new device, a new technique, a new awareness for some small child, it's not automatic. You know, they have to relearn these bad habits. Mm-hmm. I just was visiting some friends and I got a chance to meet a young man who's 23, I think 24. And they asked me to look at something. So I looked at something and, well, lift your tongue. And it's 23 or 24. He had no movement of his tongue whatsoever because it was all tied down to the tip. And I said, well, what about this? And they went, huh? You know, they 23 or 24 and it had never been brought up by all the healthcare providers. So that has to change. And so we were talking about that. Well, what if you go get that changed? What if you go into the right dentist or ENT or anybody and get that tissue modified? All right, now we have a 23, 24 year old tongue that doesn't know what to do.
Flapping around.
And so it's just incomplete treatment if you think that you have a new laser and you've got, you know, everything you need. It's not true. You know, you got to have the partners, and the partners are you guys.
1,000%. That collaborative care is just so, so important. Now, I don't know if you have an answer to this because I know you don't specifically treat children in your clinic, but do you have a favorite like myofunctional appliance, or are you indifferent?
I'm indifferent. You're right, because I don't treat these kids. My favorite appliance, I'm going to tell you a story about my friend Dave. Dave and I were sitting one day and we were talking about beer. And I said, Dave, what's your favorite beer? And his answer is, it's always the same. It's the one in front of me. And so the when people ask me about what's my favorite appliance, same answer. It's the one the patients will use. Mm-hmm. And so there is no magic appliance, not in adults, not in kids. Mm-hmm. The closest we come maybe is Mio Munchie. I think that's a fantastic little device. Mm-hmm. And it's only one of those. But once you get a little bit older, there's different devices that can be used. Mm-hmm. And the key is what does the office believe in? Mm-hmm. What are they trained to make sure they can communicate super well to the families? Mm-hmm. And what do the which video does the children seem to gravitate toward? Mm-hmm. Because it's never about the appliance. Mm-hmm. It's always about what the child thinks is going to be fun.
Right.
It's what the mom thinks is going to be useful. And if those two think parts are in place, then and it's because the team member believes in it. Mm-hmm. Well, then that passion will soak through, and then the appliance is just a tool. So no, my favorite is not the tool. My favorite is the setup.
Absolutely. And even, you know, that goes for myofunctional therapy. We just had a question last night in our course by one of the students asking, you know, when we get to the exercise part of the program, are they going to be able to relate it to, say, treating a 3 or 4 year old? Now, we would never put a 3 or 4 year old in a typical full blown myofunctional therapy program, but we can still definitely help them. But what, it's all based off of play, right? We have to make it fun for them. They have to be engaged and entertained, and you want them to mimic you, and it's making animal sounds and all different kinds of sounds to get their mouth moving and their tongue moving. And it's all, you have to target your audience, right? You have to bring it down to that level. And that's why, you know, I always say there's no age limit on myofunctional therapy. We can start them, you know, as early as we can, if they, you know, obviously can understand. And then the oldest person that I've treated with Mio is 74 right now. So you're never too old to learn something new. Compliance is key. Even with those appliances, you know, we have to wear them. That's how they work. We have to make sure that they're in and that we're being compliant. And as long as everybody's on, you know, the same page, like you said, it's not so much the appliance, but just like you said, the setup, who's behind it, what they believe in it, and that everybody is just working together to that one goal. Now, does that, is it the same as far as oral appliance therapy for sleep? Do you have a favorite appliance or a favorite manufacturer or anything like that?
Well, it's the same answer, of course. Mm-hmm. Now, I just for disclosure, I'm the clinical education director for one of the manufacturers, Airway Technologies. My 40-year friend, Dr. Keith Thornton, developed the TAP appliances, and I think they're fantastic. Mm-hmm. But even when I was talking to them about being their education director, I told Keith and Charles, I said, look, guys, I'm never going to be able to stand up in front of a group and say there's only one appliance. Mm-hmm. I just can't do that because there isn't one. You know, it's right. And some patients don't like some aspects of the TAP appliances, just like there's no other appliance out there that everybody loves.
Right.
And so when you think about little kids and what you guys do, there's several manufacturers now of these devices. Mm-hmm. And I just urge everybody that's hearing a podcast like this or going to a training, never focus on one appliance. Always have more than one choice in your practice, because that just frees your mind, for one thing. Because right. One of the problems we have in sleep medicine in the first place is that in the late 70s, Dr. Sullivan developed CPAP. And that became, wow, what a good thing we can do to fix the problem that they knew at the time, which was a closing down airway. Mm-hmm. And we know there's a lot more problems that go with this, but we still have a closing down airway. Mm-hmm. And what I find my physician colleagues doing for the most part is trying to diagnose a patient that'll use the treatment that they have. So they have a CPAP, so let's go out and find people that can use CPAPs. Mm-hmm. Well, that'd be like me taking a TAP appliance and going out in a public and saying, well, let me find people that can use a TAP appliance. Mm-hmm. Now, I'll find some. And again, it's a great appliance. I love it. But, you know, that's not the key. The key is to find people that need better health and think through their problems. And using all of the tools that we have available, including TAP appliances and mm-hmm. CPAPs and myofunctional mm-hmm. therapy, what can we do to make this work better? And the astute a clinician and a thinking person clinician was going to say, okay, I need to have a lot of ways to help my patients, a lot of tools, a lot of arrows in the quiver, as one person says it, you know, so we can make sure we apply the right therapy. Then we can be passionate about that therapy plan, mm-hmm. and the patients will feel that. And that's a beginning of them accepting the changes they have to make sure it works.
Absolutely. Now talking a little bit more about oral appliance therapy for sleep apnea, when you're fabricating an oral appliance, what's the most important factor to consider?
Yeah, I guess the acceptance of a patient of using something in their mouth.
Okay.
Every now and then we get people who say, look, I just can't imagine the concept of using something in my mouth. And that's hard to overcome. Once we get past that, and that's not very common, but it's mm-hmm. there, then people have to say, okay, I'm going to have to cooperate with this, because this isn't surgery. This isn't dentistry where we go in and do a restoration and a patient has to passively participate. This is something they have to actively be part of the therapy. So we have to bring them to the realization that there is something wrong in their health or their quality of life. And it's worth doing active things to make that better. When they believe that, wow, snoring really is a problem for me, and I'm going to do what it takes to get rid of snoring, mm-hmm. then they'll accept the treatment that we have to do, and we can go over that. So again, not about the appliance, although what we do are able to do with 150 kinds of appliances or so, is we can generally match up some characteristics that patients find important. Like, for example, the TAP appliance is great if somebody says, well, you know, I really want to be able to sleep on my back. And so I can talk about how if the jaw relaxes, the TAP keeps them from their jaw from falling backwards. Mm-hmm. But the person who is, you know, going to suffer from PTSD if their mouth is, quote, locked closed because it's connected top and bottom, not going to be happy with that. And if they're not happy going into the therapy, it's difficult to overcome that barrier to make sure that they'll cooperate with what they have to do. So we can choose another appliance that allows them to express their concerns, and we can address those and say, well, as a matter of fact, this appliance doesn't lock your mouth closed and hold your mouth forward this way. You know, so it's that, that's how we can do things like that.
Yeah, keeping it very individualized. I love that. Now, what about the patients that don't, so as a dentist for mild to moderate, you know, we can fabricate oral appliances. Now, what about the patients that don't actually have sleep apnea, that aren't showing apneic events, but say have a really high RDI? How would you go about treating them?
Well, wait a minute, let's back up just a wee bit. In that when oral appliances came around and CPAP was already dominating the thinking, and then the guidelines came out that says, wait a minute, CPAPs are better at treating AHI and better than oral appliances. And so we're gonna designate that oral appliances are for mild cases and that CPAPs are for everything else unless and until they reject it. Well, there's new science, Brittany. And the new science is showing that the mean disease alleviation, in other words, the biggest, the impact on the physiology, the change in the things that are going wrong is the same for CPAPs and oral appliances across the board. No longer do we have to consider that that severe sleep apnea is only the province of PAP devices. Now, I'm not saying that oral appliances are, you know, complete winners, but there's nothing wrong with trying them. So we got to get away from the thinking of it's only for mild cases, because anybody could benefit from them. And it's no different for a mild case than a severe case. We always have to follow them. It's a management issue. And so we can follow a severe case. We can follow a mild case. Sometimes we use combination therapy, lots of things we can do. So what about the patient who comes in and says, well, you know, I'm feeling bad. And they have a screener and they say, okay, there must be something wrong here. So we get a diagnosis of some type and they fall under the clinical definition of obstructive sleep apnea. Okay, they don't have that problem, according to medicine, but they still have a significant quality of life issue. They still have maybe even a medical issue, but it just didn't test out that way. Well, there's too many night-to-night variabilities in testing for me to believe in all of that, but they're still sitting in my office thinking, I feel bad. You know, there's something wrong for me. Fix me if you can. And you're the airway guy. You're supposed to know what to do. So what are we going to do? And So you know what we do, Brittany? We make the same appliances because it's very frequently an airway issue because of a narrow airway space. Mm-hmm. And the behavior of the airway, the oral pharynx in our terms, at nighttime is still collapsing and therefore causing more work for the body to do to breathe. That wakes up the brain because more work is involved, and then they get a terrible night's sleep and they accumulate the stress and it's all bad on them. So we oftentimes have to just open the airway, but there's other things we can think about. We help to open the nose. We give them strategies for making sure they can breathe well through their nose. We force them to breathe through their nose. There's that bad habit again, because if people are in habits of mouth breathing, we can redirect that in a number of ways, including things like putting little tape over their lips. Mm-hmm. To and of course they do that, we don't. And so you know, it's not like I show up at nighttime, so it's time for your lip. But we do. We educate them about nose breathing. We get them to the, we get them to the orthodontist, because a ton of people still these days have been, are legacies of orthodontics that was aimed at aligning teeth and getting the bite correct for the jaw joints, excellent goals, but not really paying attention to the structure underneath. They dealt with the structure they had as opposed to the structure they could have had. Mm-hmm. And to get the proper bony structure that surrounds the airway, the floor of the nose, the front of the oral pharynx, all those things, to get the right bony structure, we have to address that in 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 year olds. Mm-hmm. And that's back to the province of dentists. That's the only people that can do that. And so it all circles back to, what are we going to do for a 4-year-old?
Absolutely. And one more question about adult patients. What is your take?
I'm talking about kids. You keep talking about adults.
Okay. One more question. Then we'll go to kids. Night guards. What are your thoughts on traditional night guards that you learn in dental school to give to like everybody that clenches or grinds their teeth or is stressed?
Well, that's, you know, there's nothing wrong with night guards except this. A lot of people who are clenching and grinding their teeth are doing so because they have an active brain. Mm-hmm. And so their active brain, active sympathetic nervous system, actually, in some people seems to trigger extra muscle activity of the closing muscles. We don't know why, and we don't know why some and not others, mm-hmm. but our experts tell us that there's multiple factors. So if we think about what could be causing an active brain, a sympathetic nervous system upregulation, one of the primary drivers of that is a body that's trying to breathe better at nighttime. So that means that if you have a patient in your dental practice and they're a known bruxer or grinder, you see the teeth, they complain about this, they have muscle pains, they wake up with headaches, all the classic signs, then I think it's perfectly okay to protect them from this bad habit by making them a night guard, as long as you've ruled out the breathing problem. So these days, it's becoming easier and easier to rule out the breathing problem. We can, as dentists, can use some simple sleep apnea testing devices in most states, not all states, so you have to be careful, but in every state, we can use high-resolution pulse oximeters. One of them is by a company called Patient Safety, Inc. I like that one a lot. And another one's by Sleep Image. And now there's others out there. But if we think about the patient safety one with high resolution pulse oximetry, it gives us a window into their physiology, into their sympathetic activation, specifically the RDI that you mentioned, as a matter of fact. And so we can see what's going on. And that is it's an oximeter. Mm-hmm. Doesn't hurt. Our license says we can use oximeters for good reasons. So we send our patients home with that. And if they test out to having, you know, really not a big issue with breathing problems and oxygen levels are fine, well, then we use a night guard. Now, there's been some studies that show that on some people, night guards make the airway worse. And some people, it makes the airway better. And so it's incumbent upon us dentists now that there are these simple testing devices available that we can't just simply make a night guard and call it good. That's now substandard. So we have to test a little bit first, see kind of where we are, and then make the night guard help them with all their sore muscles and their bad and their sore teeth and protect their enamel, all the great things we do with night guards. But then we also have to measure the physiologic response a bit too. And it's so simple, cheap, and kind of really interesting to do that there's no reason not to do that anymore.
Definitely. I recently had spoken to a group of hygienists, and I pretty much told them when they have a patient in their chair that clenches or grinds their teeth, I want their first red flag to be airway, like light bulbs off. And I think I gave the dentist a heart attack. He was like, "Did you just tell my hygienist not to recommend night guards anymore?" And I'm like, "I didn't say that. I said, but let's not just jump to that."
That's excellent, Brittany. Good. Well done.
So I want to now kind of backtrack a little bit. We touched briefly on the craniofacial respiratory complex. And for anybody that has not ever listened to a Dr. Kevin Boyd lecture or really knows what exactly we mean by that, can you just expand a little bit more on that?
Love to. If you look at the American Dental Association's definition of dentistry, it says that we have responsibility for the oral cavity, teeth, gums, all the things that we would expect. But then there's a powerful phrase that goes with that. It says all that oral cavity stuff, and it says, and adjacent and associated structures and their impact on the rest of the human body. Well, what's adjacent to the oral cavity but the nose and the oral pharynx? And does that mean we're ear, nose, and throat doctors? It doesn't, but it does mean that we have to be able to assess those other parts of the body and think about how problems in those areas could affect the rest of the body. So it's not just about teeth and gums, it's about the nose, it's about the oropharynx. And that means we are dealing with the upper airway. Mm-hmm. And that is the craniofacial respiratory complex that Dr. Boyd talks about. It's not just thinking about one part of it, which medicine kind of assigns to us and forgets about with the oral cavity. But in fact, the reach out from dentistry into medicine as we intersect with ear, nose, and throat physicians and general practice physicians about the health and performance of the nose and oropharynx. And so that means we think three-dimensionally. In fact, it's actually kind of 4D, four-dimensionally. I'll come to that in a second. But your training as a dental hygienist, your training as a myofunctional therapist, our training as dentists are all about that same anatomy, the head and neck anatomy. And so there's no reason for us to lose the ability to think about the three-dimensional airway of and how it works, and the fourth dimension of how it changes over time. Again, back to my little kids, all the way into my 70-year-olds, your little ones in myofunctional therapy to your 74-year-old. You know, there's a time factor here. And so we have to think about not just what happens to the craniofacial respiratory complex, but also what happens to that over time. And what can we do early? What do we have to do later? All those things.
Absolutely. Is there anything else that you would like to touch upon? Anything you want to talk more about, which I don't know if you can, in regards to, you know, everything that you're working on with the ADA and the new screener that's coming out? Anything else that we did not cover that you'd like to talk about?
A couple of things. The screener tool that the ADA mandated, the House of Delegates in 2019 told ADA, develop one. I already had a task force working off of that 2018 meeting. And so the Children's Airway Screener Task Force, or CAST, has developed a 5-question screener so far. And I'm very excited that the ADA continues to support this. And we're going to have a meeting in April where we're going to establish the protocols for getting it validated. Mm-hmm. So it'll become a tool that can be used not just in dental offices, but in school nursing, in school everything, and around the world. Because you think about little kids, I keep coming back to that, don't I? Little kids go to school. What happens? They get a hearing screening. They get a vision screening. Mm-hmm. They need to get an airway screening at the same time. And we're making that possible. And then we're going to have on April 22nd and 23rd, we're going to have our fourth Children's Airway CE event. You can see that more about that ada.org/CE live, ada.org/CE live. And so that's an inexpensive and really exciting program. And Sharon Moore, who wrote the book Sleep Wrecked Kids, mm-hmm. that every dental office in the world should hand out to all of their families. Sharon's going to be leading us off on Thursday night, the 22nd. So nobody should miss that one. And two incredible pediatric dentists on Friday, Dr. Lauren Mahadas and Carla Damon from Dallas are going to be speaking on Friday. And then Sarush Zaghi, who's a big champion, he's a MD ENT doctor, of course, and he's a tethered oral tissues doctor, but he's a huge fan of myofunctional therapy, mm-hmm. is going to be on that too. And then it'll be a research opportunity. It's an exciting event.
And this is going to be live?
It's virtual, you know, it's on screen, but it's all live, yes. And April 22nd and 23rd.
I'll make sure to link that in the show notes for sure.
Excellent. That'd be very helpful. You can go to that website and then you can see a little blurb for it and everything. What else? You asked me about something else I was going to say. I don't want to talk about office systems. One of the dangers of getting all excited about doing this is you get your hygienist all up to speed on checking Mal and Patty for adults or breathing patterns for kids. And the dentist comes in and the hygienist gives this nice report about this. And now the dentist goes off for 20 minutes talking about the importance of breathing and all these cool things. And meanwhile, the poor hygienist is trying to get the chair cleared so she can get her next patient. You might have lived through something like that in the past. So what I urge offices to do is to have, it's a team effort. You got to have everybody sit down and say, okay, how are we going to make this work for us? Mm-hmm. Because the danger of causing a disruption like that is the hygienist says, I'm never going to say anything ever again. You know, mm-hmm. the assistant's going to go, he's behind, he's over there talking, and I got to get this crown done. The front desk person is looking at the waiting room full of people that are late for their appointments. Nobody's happy. Mm-hmm. And so the team has to sit down and develop a system. So the hygienist says, wow, you know, look at this airway. And she comes in and says, doctor, look at this airway. And there's got to be a place for that patient to go, a person for them to talk to, that's not the hygienist, that's not the dentist, mm-hmm. and get that initial information across and then set up another appointment for a more in-depth discussion, whatever seems appropriate. But if you don't do that carefully, then it poisons the office and it becomes an unfortunate outcome. So I was used to be a trainer for the Pride Institute, which is an office systems trainer, and Amy Morgan there just drilled into me the importance of creating team systems. Jim Pride had a plaque on his desk that said, "You may be smarter than me, but you're not smarter than me and my team." And love that, because that is so true. You know, I'm a smart enough guy, but my team and I are way smarter than just me. And so you always make it a team effort. It's a team game. It's a team outcome, team rewards. Mm-hmm. It's a fantastic thing that every dental office can incorporate to some level in their practice and make a difference.
Yeah. And I think it makes the patient feel, you know, even more comfortable knowing that they're hearing the same thing, no matter who they're talking to, clinical, front desk, whoever it is, that everybody, you know, is on the same page and has the education to really be able to continue and keep spreading this awareness and reinforcing everything, you know, the doctor and the hygienist says. So I love that you mentioned that, because I know I'm not currently practicing clinical hygiene anymore, but there is no worse feeling than running over and you want to like, stop talking. You're talking about good stuff, but please do it somewhere else.
Exactly. Yeah. Ask me how I learned that so carefully, Brittany.
Uh-oh. Well, Dr. Carstensen, thank you so, so much for taking the time to come on here and chat. And we'll definitely have to have you back on again sometime.
I loved it. And thank you for being such an important part of education out there. Because it's people like you that can bring the message to a lot of other people, and that gets them curious. And they'll look for a way to learn from Dr. Moralia or from me or from any of the other great teachers out there. And that just brings our whole profession up, doesn't it? And it's fantastic.
1,000%. And it gets me so very excited. So thank you so, so much.